when we built Scala, because it's sort of this a new brand of language, a new paradigm of language, we didn't really have very good foundations.
This is Martin Odosky, full professor of the IC School at EPFL and founder of the Scala programming language.
We improvised a little bit, and so we built it on sort of more, sometimes we built it on hunches and not really formal theories. So we have to a degree caught up with that. In recent years, we have done a much better job at actually developing a theory and proving the theory sound. And the next step will be really to connect that better to the language. That means to essentially see what we have to revise in the language and the compiler to build this thing more solidly on the theory. So that's the next challenge over the next years.
What kind of theory is Martin Odosky talking about?
What we did was we developed a calculus called DOT, DOT, for dependent object types, which is essentially a mini language. The syntax fits on half a page, so that's just large. That's just small enough that you can still analyze it formally. We gave essentially the typing rules and the operational semantics. And we proved that essentially when we execute the program, then the types are essentially are maintained. That means the types don't lie to you. So that's the soundness things that you want to prove about these calculi. And that was very hard. That took us more than 8 years to do that. But over these 8 years, we also learned a lot of things in language designs, like what is okay and what you have to avoid. And that will now flow into the next version of Scala, the lessons we've learned there.
More generally, there's a sweet spot to be found where programmers effortlessly know what to type to get their codes running, but as well will be able to detect and fix bugs in their codes. The use of so-called types has become a very powerful tool to do just that, and so-called dependent object types will hopefully even more facilitate programmers' code writing. Typing could also better clarify the inner working of Scala's functional programming.
In the case of current Scala, it means a functional language is one which makes it very easy and pleasant to write code with functions. There's another meaning to say, well, all you have is functions, pure mathematical functions. You can't write any other code. And there are actually no languages that are as strict, because it turns out that at some point computers have to do some effect to things. But there's a language, essentially the predominant functional language, purely functional language, that's Haskell. And there, essentially, you have the types tell you. So if you want to have a side effect, you have to declare that in the type. So the types tell you, by default, everything is pure. And if you want to have a side effect, the type tells you. It would be very interesting to see whether we can evolve Scala to be a language like that as well. So that we don't just check, in a sense, that's the classical typing, but that the types also check the effects that a program could have. And there we made some initial progress to use something called implicit parameters as capabilities. So a capability is essentially something you can do. And the idea is to say, well, instead of saying a program has an effect, we say it needs the capability to have an effect. So like, for instance, an effect could be this program, it could terminate normally, or it could throw an exception. So that's a typical thing. And we would phrase that to say, well, the program has its normal result type, but it also needs the capability to throw an exception. You have to give that to the program. And that way you see it in the type. So presumably if the program needs a capability to throw an exception, that it might throw an exception on some path. So you see it in the types just as well as with the other things. And it turns out that approach seems to mesh well with like the other abstractions we have in Scala. But nobody has done it yet, so that's an open research question whether we can do it.
The holy grail would be to be able to foresee potential troubles with the code so that a programmer better understands his code without having to execute it. But typing is not the only challenge that creating a programming language raises.
The other one is a challenge of usability, I would say. So one thing that is again fairly particular for Scala is that it's a very general language. It doesn't really restrain you at all how you want to program. In a sense, it's natural that it's a bridge language from object-oriented to functional, so it has to adapt to many different styles. And in some cases, I think that went too far, that people use the freedom to write code bases that then were very hard to understand later. I guess that happens in every language, but I believe in Scala it happened more often than maybe in some other languages. So one challenge is essentially, can we develop an ergonomic theory to say, well, what is ergonomically good code and how can we nudge people to write good code? And that's something much less precise and much less mathematic, but nevertheless important, I think.
This is hugely important. Computer codes are not written only so that computers can execute them. Computer codes should also be easily readable so that any human can make fixes to computer code. Ideally, there would be one canonical way to write code so that any programmer would write the code the same way. Thereby, it'd be easy for a programmer to read a code because the code would be exactly what he expected to be. One way to achieve this canonical way to write codes is by proposing guidelines, but these are usually not sufficient. It turns out that rigidifying the language, as is the case for Java, is a great way to get programmers to write codes in the same way.
And the other big question is, for this one and many other things, is now we want to make progress in like these language design and like tracking effects and things like that. But we have a huge installed code base, many, many millions of lines of code. I mean, there are many companies, there are several companies that each of them has many millions of lines of code. So how can we do that and bring the code base over? And that's a very complicated and tricky question, and we'll see how that will work out. We don't have definite answers for that yet.
We won. We actually successfully took over the big data world, and this is a talk about why.
Functional programming and object-oriented programming up to then haven't really been combined much. There were some attempts, but they were not really successful, and Scala is sort of the first mainstream language that does that.